Bernard de Montreal. Preparatory communication number 35. Karma, the law of return. Karma ceases with the development of pure intelligence, or supramental consciousness. Karma, or the law of return, ceases to have an influence on the life of man when he begins to live from his real intelligence. The law of return is not eternal, it must stop sooner or later. As soon as man is relieved from this law, he is no longer subject to the suffering associated with his previous lives. But the fundamental condition is the use of his real intelligence. Intelligence that allows him to stop living according to the laws of emotion and live according to the laws of the spirit. It is necessary for man to understand that intelligence is the only force in him that can free him from the law of return. The law of return must be abolished on the planet, because it delays the evolution of man and civilization. Although this law is in conformity with the nature of the soul's memory, its application from one life to another makes it difficult for man and his real freedom to flourish. The law of return must be abolished, as it contributes to the domination of the past over life. Man does not realize the negative aspect of the law of return, because he perceives it only through the principle of absolute justice of life. This point of view is right in the sense that we reap what we have sown. But seen from the point of view of the evolution of man, it is also right and necessary that this law be abolished, and only man can abolish it. The law of return underlines the past of man. And as the man of tomorrow will live only from his pure and present consciousness, the law will no longer have any effect on him, because man will no longer act according to his inferior nature, but according to the superior intelligence in him. The law of return began when the ego of man began to interfere with the laws of the soul. As the ego separated from the soul, the law of return became more and more effective, so that the return of the ego in material world became inevitable, so that the accumulated experience could be used over time to conquer the soul on it. The law of return served to promote human experience and the formation of the cycles that gave rise to the different civilizations on the planet. If the ego had not separated from the soul, the evolution of life on Earth would have been different, and man today would be different, as would his civilization. But he could not be individualized. However, the ego separated from the soul because the latter's experience was insufficient when he descended into the material plane. Its power over the material plane weakens with age, and the power of the ego, on the contrary, grows. So that with time, the soul became a prisoner of material world and could only be free from it at the time of material death. Material death freed the soul but forced the ego to return to the spirit world, embellished by its increasingly discordant thoughts and emotions. Over the ages, these astral worlds were to become real garbage cans, real reserves of energies of lower vibrations that coincided with the memory of selfish experiences. The ego was trapped in these worlds and sought to return to material world in order to correct its errors, in order to eventually renew its link with light, with the soul. When the ego incarnated, the soul was forced to join him, because it attracted him into the material world. If the soul had not joined the ego that wanted to incarnate in order to evolve, the latter would have died before birth. That explains the premature deaths. They reflect the lack of desire of the soul to unite itself to the ego that wants to incarnate, in order to live a necessary experience for some time. In this case, the refusal of the soul comes from the fact that the ego seeks to reincarnate to add to its negative experience, rather than to raise its level of experience. The soul then does not want to bind itself to him, hoping that he will understand, during his evolution in the astral worlds, the illusion of his choice. When he has understood, when he has studied his life plan carefully, he will seek a condition conducive to his evolution, and the soul will then connect to him, in order to help him to rise in vibration, so that one day, it can act through him. The soul seeks to dominate the ego, for it represents on earth the most universal part of man. As long as the ego is not sufficiently aware of this, the soul suffers, because it only makes his experience more difficult on the material level. The soul is willing to descend into material world, provided that the ego will not blindly bend to material conditions, but seeks to see beyond them. As long as the soul does not have this certainty, it seeks to delay its entry into matter, and the ego must remain on the plane of death. The law of return. Because of this situation between the ego and the soul, can affect the latter for many centuries, which does not facilitate the task of the soul, which must connect to him under all kinds of conditions, when in fact it could, if the ego was sufficiently evolved, if it was conscious of itself, provide him with all the necessary elements so that it can free itself from the law of return within a single life and enter the immortal life. The law of return is a fixed law as long as it remains, in order to allow readjustment of the vibration of the soul which is disturbed by the unconsciousness of the ego. The vibration of the soul must adjust itself during the ego's return to the material world, until the day when the soul, sufficiently adjusted, can enter into union with him, and prepare him for the penetration of universal intelligence. When the ego recognizes the vibration of the soul in him, it is because he has evolved sufficiently to participate in the domination of the form, under the eye of the real intelligence, within the absolute framework of that intelligence. It is from this moment in the evolution of man that he lives less and less under the law of return. It must be understood that the law of return can only be extinguished when the individual has reached a sufficient consciousness that allows him to live on a plane of intelligence free of veils. From that intelligence which results from the union between the soul, the ego and the thought adjuster. The law of return only affects man when he accumulates false vibrations, when he does not understand the law of conscious action. Any conscious action serves to change man and the society of man. For it does not contain astrality. It is not self-centered and does not seek to confirm the ego in its primitive consciousness, but to situate him within a framework of creative actions considered perfect by the soul, and adjusted to the vibration of the soul in the ego. The law of return is a monster barrier against man. This is why subjective memory must be weakened, increasingly replaced by pure and instantaneous consciousness. This instant consciousness does not care about the memory of the ego, because it is above it. However, instant consciousness is the perfect relationship between the ego and the soul. The more perfect this relationship is, the more egoistic, egocentric memory loses its power over man, and the more the latter frees him from the law of return. But for man to be totally free from this law, from the effect of his involutive memory, he must be able to absorb the strength of the soul in him, and never succumb to doubt and the machination of the emotional form, for doubt is part of man's memory. If the ego is strong enough to support the action of the soul, he suffers in himself the subjective destruction of his memory, which is the seat of the law of return. This is why it is so important for the ego to know that forms are traps linked to his lack of experience, meaning linked to one form or another of unconsciousness. And it is in these forms that he is trapped and lives in actions likely to make him liable to the law of return. The law of return is not a cosmic law, but a planetary law. And every planetary law must eventually be abolished, so that man can live cosmically, that is to say universally. As long as he is linked to the law of return, it is impossible for him to generate, on one level or another, enough energy to live by the strength of the soul in his vibration. Men believe, and because they believe, tend to accept their beliefs, and these same beliefs block their vision and understanding of reality. And these same men then complain about their quality of life. This is not surprising, since they did not know, and could not take responsibility for their knowledge on their own shoulders. If the law of return has become such a rigid law, it is because man has not been able to get rid of it. He did not understand the laws of memory. Subjective memory is a prison because it conditions life in the past. And it is this form of conditioning that prevents man from knowing what he considers impossible. And as soon as man is trapped in his powerlessness, he cannot generate in himself the reality which is the very manifestation of his power. The law of return, subjective memory, subjective thoughts, the form that imprisons, are the walls of the ego, his limits, that lead him to certain death. The law of return stems from ignorance and fear of the ego. And as long as the latter hides in this filthy life, the law continues to operate against him, because it brings him back to his helplessness, because it does not allow him to make full use of the pure will and intelligence in him, or his intelligent will. The law of return is a nocturnal law, which means that it is not powered by solar forces, but by lunar forces. And these forces are already anti-human enough to delay an entire humanity for thousands and thousands of years, as long as they are not controlled by the conscious ego. But the ego is so weak of will that it has difficulty separating from his memory. And it is only during his evolution towards real intelligence that he is finally free in his will and can tear the veil of time, the veil that prevents him from knowing. The ego must abolish the law of return, and only the ego can do so. The soul cannot do it for him, because the soul is not subject to planetary laws. Only the ego can increase in himself the vibratory power to develop the mental and emotional resistance that allows him to destroy intellectual memory, and thereby neutralize astral memory, or the memory of emotions, because it is from the astral memory of man that the conditions for his return are formed. However, the astral actions of man, the actions that are riddled with emotion, if they are positive, create a positive memory, and if they are negative, create a negative memory. But whether memory is positive or negative, it remains a condition of involution, because any astral memory is nourished only by what is egocentric. However, planetary memory must be replaced by universal memory, by universal intelligence and its creative action. Man, of course, in the past, considered good deeds as meritorious and others as bad. This allowed him to develop some value that he could do on his own. But this value nevertheless remained unconscious and astral, for the action was not intelligent, in the sense that it was not a vibratory impulse of the universal intelligence that unites the soul, the ego and the personality. This is why men accumulated either an asset or a memorable liability, which became the foundation of the law of return on the material level. But now that man is preparing to come into contact with real intelligence, all the conditions of his life are changing, so that the liabilities or assets of his memory no longer have any influence on him, because he can no longer act astrally meaning with emotion. He will simply do. And when man simply does, he no longer creates astral memory, because he no longer uses the astral body to act except under the vibratory control of the universal intelligence, thus reducing the planetary power over his growing human consciousness. Although the astral body is the great responsible for the law of return, which is a law of memory, once man is conscious, no longer has power itself, because the higher mind reigns in him or over him. The axis is then formed, and it is said that the soul, the ego, and the personality are united. Education, culture, and all forms of impressions received by the senses create an emotional astral dependence in man, and force him to constantly return to the past of human experience, to the memory of experience. But when man becomes aware, these forces lose their power over him, and he begins to live differently. He begins to break the circle of forms that keep his memory alive, because it is through form that memory is maintained and developed. Kill the forms, and the memory disappears. But man does not yet understand what memory means. Subjective memory is a category of vibratory forces that imprison the mind and prevent man from freely realizing himself in the instantaneous state of pure and universal intelligence. As soon as this memory is weakened, the spirit of man grows, and the law of return loses its power over him, because man acts in the instantaneous, what you call the present. One of the important aspects of the law of return is that the soul only seeks to evolve, and that everything serves it. But the ego, once conscious, is fed up with the evolution of the soul, because he no longer wants to suffer. This is where the struggle between the conscious ego and the soul that wants and only seeks to evolve lies. The only protection of the ego against suffering, at this stage, is the universal intelligence in him, and the universal will. Man has difficulty understanding the role of his soul. He has the impression that the soul is superior in him, and that he owes it everything, that his life depends unconditionally on it. His life, meaning the spirit of his life, depends on the soul, because it is the atomic support of man. It is the soul that energizes man atomically. But man is a being in the process of becoming, meaning his consciousness must and can rise above the atomic consciousness and become vitalized, meaning to become the expression of universal will, intelligence and love. However, these principles are cosmic and universal, and it is from these principles that man must live. When these principles are consciously lived, the atomic power of the soul is transferred from the universal plane to the human plane, and man is no longer dominated by the soul, but dominates it. For he is in the light. That is why it is essential that man understands the laws of form, because once he knows them, he can no longer be subject to the laws of energy and the laws of the soul. He is the law, and the energy obeys him. The law of return stems from ignorance. It delays the evolution of humanity, because man is the bearer of the past. However, the past is the memory of man, conscious or unconscious, and this memory must be annihilated. But it can only be annihilated when he has begun to understand his ignorance and look beyond what emotionally connects him to the form. However, this new consciousness does not depend on the ego at the beginning, but on the evolutionary stage of the soul. It is only when the ego has been put in resonance with it that it begins to bring down to the plane of life the three principles, love, will, intelligence, which constitute with time the essential elements of his real and perfect freedom, because from that moment on, he slowly and gradually begins to free himself from his memory and to live more and more in the present of his real intelligence. Since he no longer lives in the past, he diminishes in himself the restrictive power of the soul over his life, because the soul is nourished by experience. And any experience in the unconscious man is colored by the past, thus it is not lived in the present of pure intelligence. As long as man has not understood the restrictive power of the soul, he cannot imagine what freedom is. For freedom is precisely the impossibility for the soul to use the blind experience of the ego for its own evolution. Thus man discovers the need to abolish the law of return, not for philosophical reasons, but for real reasons of free life. But free life is only known as the conscious ego, intelligent and voluntary, categorically refuses to be a pawn in the game of life, and transforms the game of life of which he is only a victim, into power of life. It is the power of life that he must live, in order to extinguish forever the law of return in him. The law of return is not contemplated philosophically. It is situated in the mind of man and is understood only when his intelligence pierces the veils of personal and subjective thought, to continue further into the pure realms of unconditional and objective cosmic intelligence. Whether man knows or not is not the question here. That man, one day, must have known, that is the purpose of his evolution. For it is only in this movement of his mind towards the light that he can finally realize himself perfectly at the height of what he is, at the height of what he can, at the height of his creative and vital intelligence. Man has no limits. And it is only when he destroys his false limits that he enters the vast field of creative life and movement. Man is a being in power, and all men have in them that power which gives them power over life and death. Man's life is not contemplated from the balcony of his personal thought. It is contemplated from the movement of his real intelligence and will. It is here that the chains of life and death are broken. For then man no longer belongs to the sons of man, but to the sons of light. They are the sons of light who have given, in the past, to man. And it will be these same sons who will give to man in the future. For it is these beings who are constantly evolving towards perfection. That is why, where the law of return applies, there cannot be sufficient light. For this law is a reflection of darkness in man, of despicable, blind and perverse ignorance. It is only the growing energy in man that can make him realize that the law of return is a bad dream, that it is a chain, and that only will and intelligence can break this chain. But man always waits before moving forward, because he always seems to need some experience before moving forward towards the center of himself. Until he has smelled the deceit and understood the law of the deceit, he does not seem willing to act in victory. He then always finds himself in the red, in some kind of debt in front of life, instead of being on an equal footing with life. In other words, man has no real will because his intelligence is not sufficiently real. And all this because of his famous emotions. The measure of everything is in the conquest of what does not suit us. But it is difficult for man to see things in this way, because the life he has always led was commensurate with his emotions. As long as the law of return lasts on Earth, the life of man and the planet will be disrupted. For this law constantly generates actions that reflect man's planetary unease, meaning his lack of perfect harmony with the light in him. But man is beginning to suffer on such a large scale the shock of this law. So the day will come when he will open his eyes and seek in himself the answer to this dilemma. Because the earth is patient, but man, because of his memory, reduces the patience of his planet. And the day must come when everything within these immeasurable forces will seek to transform itself. Man will be part of this rebirth and will be forced to face the reality of the planet. And reality is always greater, more merciless, than the intellectual, philosophical or spiritual imagination can project it. Because reality always takes into consideration, in its movement, the law of return. However, if man is a prisoner of this law, when reality falls on his globe, his life becomes unbearable, because his memory, which is the unconsciousness of his emotions, instantly fills his brain and madness is generated. Because madness is the relationship between man and the memory of his emotions. It is triggered when man can no longer move forward in life, because he can no longer absorb new emotional experiences. The law of return seeks to contain man, to limit him. It is experientially progressive, but it is cosmically retarded. For one day or another, man must dominate the energy of the spirit in order to build a new world. It is obvious that man can only act cosmically when his planetary life is transposed into a broader plan of evolution, where the experience of the ego, the egocentric experience, is no longer necessary, since all his actions are the product of the light in him that has become a channel. But the law of return is powerful. It is indomitable. As long as man has not put his foot firmly in his intelligence. The power of the law can only be rivaled and surpassed by the solar power in man. And this solar power is located in his higher mind, where the emotion and the subjective thought that makes it pulsate in him have no power, have no hold. Until mankind understands the need to destroy the chains of the law of return, he will not have understood why he is on Earth. For the material Earth is not the final place of the incarnate man. It is simply the very long stepping stone to the ether, to a world, and to a way of life, which can only be known when the past no longer has an effect on human behavior. When the past that is no longer recorded in human actions today. The law of return is a very large-scale law, in the sense that it holds the purse of all imperfectly materialized energy expenditures. This law represents the largest and most unimaginable construction of life plans in the universe. It determines in the smallest details the future relationship between man and his planetary suffering. For man to stop suffering on the Earth, he must understand the laws of life so well that only this understanding is sufficient to counterbalance the weight of the law of return. But at what cost? At the cost of an accurate and intelligent perception of the effect of one's emotions on his behavior. Man is not only dreaded for man because of his emotions. He is also dreaded for life. For the more material life has control over him through his subjectivity, the more he has control in return over man, and the vicious circle is closed. And when the vicious circle is closed, it is only through the center that it can be destroyed. Because it is only through the center that it can be reduced to zero, to be annihilated. And this center is man, the real man. But the movement towards the center is not easy, because the wheel of death is constantly turning, and man is projected onto his exterior where he clings to it. Man wants to live. And since he knows no life other than the one he has known among other men, he cannot see the center of the wheel. Everything is too quiet and veiled. And yet, he has the choice to die or to live. To move from the outside to the center of the wheel. The law of return is centrifugal. But as long as man has not felt his power over him, he does not realize it and remains trapped, clinging to the endless spinning wheel. When we say that man must live from himself, we are talking about this center of the wheel. But first he must discover it, this center, realize its power. And this only happens when he comes out of his intellectual and emotional subjectivity and looks himself in the face, where what he sees must be transformed, until the day when what he sees can be what it must be, what he wants to live. In the process of destroying the law of return, we discover two essential elements, the centrality and action of intelligence and will through the channel man. However, centricity makes man discover the illusions of the form that his memory maintains, thus feeding the law of return. And the union of intelligence and will through man leads him to pierce the veils of these forms, in order to neutralize the law of return for the benefit of a continuous consciousness and a life that goes beyond the limits of material death. As long as material death is not realized as an insult to the power of life in man, it is obvious that the very nature of this experience cannot be grasped in its most concrete totality, which is the irrevocable effect of the law of life cycles. If life cycles exist on Earth, it is because man has not known in general, apart from the great insiders of the past, how to remember anything, meaning how to live from the pure consciousness that enlightens, directs and creates through man, in order to benefit him materially and benefit him immaterially, on the plane of the worlds of light that plunge the roots of their reality, where matter ceases to be maintained in balance by the planetary forces of gravity and the internal forces of the atom. The law of return is similar to the law of the tax authorities. It is inviolable as long as man is subject to it. What is most difficult about the experience of the ego is to realize that everything that he is mentally and emotionally is not from him, from his center, but from outside of him. And that he can change all this, if he stops at a given moment, to perceive that little point of light in him, who wants to talk to him, if he wants to hear it well. But the ego is so passionate about his memory that he fears that the small point of light will make him lose it. So he lowers the curtain and stays in the dark. Everything is then over for him, because the law of return remains active in him. But if he keeps the curtain of his mind open and looks at the little point of light, that point will grow, and soon he will see that the little point is very intelligent, and he does not need his memory to create in him a real vision of things. From that moment on, the law of return begins to retreat before him, and soon can no longer reach him because he loses the emotional and intellectual memory of his actions. So that instead of recording in the annals of his astral memory, it is recorded in the annals of cosmic memory. And he, as a being, no longer has an egocentric responsibility linked to his acts, because these acts are no longer his acts, but the action of the three principles united in him that now determine the curve of his evolution. as long as man does not tear the veil of his obsession with the emotion, as long as suffering does not generate in him enough energy that he can use to coldly tear this veil, he is a prisoner and all his past is reflected in his present. If man's past is reflected in his present, he is not in the energy of life, but in the gradual instance of material death. He is born to die instead of being born for a world that is foreign to the law of life cycles. No one other than himself can bind and no one other than himself can untie. Life is life, and nothing of life is found in the narrow corridor of existence. Life is energy, existence is the imagination of energy.